Hello and welcome to Podcast Bridging Voices, the online discussion forum of the Multinational Development Policy Dialogue of the Konrad Adenauer Foundation in Brussels. My name is Louis Mourier, Program Manager for Climate Policy at the Foundation, and today we're discussing the EU's water diplomacy in Central Asia. Last year, in November, CAS and the East-West Institute launched a new joint working group on the future of the EU's water diplomacy in the most water-stressed regions of the world. And just recently, we had our second joint working group session, focusing on hydro diplomacy in Central Asia. And today, we would like to follow up on the key issues that were addressed during that meeting. And for that, I'm very happy that I'm joined by our partner, Fava Ama, who will co-moderate today's discussion with me. Hi, Fava, how are you doing?
Hi, doing really well. Thanks.
Great to have you back on board for a podcast. But of course, we're not alone, Fava. Actually, we are joined by two excellent Central Asian experts who participated in our last joint working group session. With us is Dinara Sigancina, Deputy Director of the Scientific Information Center of the Interstate Commission for Water Coordination in Central Asia. Hi, Dinara.
Hello.
And we also have Jennifer Zering, Senior Lecturer in Water Governance and Diplomacy from the IHE Delft Institute in The Hague. Hi, Jennifer.
Hello, Louis.
Wonderful. Very happy to have you all on board. Just to give a little bit of context, I think as we all know, Central Asia has long been a focus area of the international water community, not only because the region is faced with substantial water and climate-related challenges, but also because this is an area where the prerequisites for effective water diplomacy seem much better compared to other parts of the world, at least at first glance. Because in Central Asia, riparian countries already signed numerous water sharing agreements and established an institutional framework for transboundary water governance, the so-called International Fund for the Aral Sea. But of course, all that glitters is not gold. And during our joint working group session, we learned that the transboundary water governance mechanisms that have been created in Central Asia have so far proven unable to provide sustainable solutions to the increasing water challenges of Central Asia. Jennifer, let me come to you for the first question. You're an expert with a strong research experience on institutional arrangements in the region. It would be great to hear your take on the effectiveness of the existing water institutions. Many deplore, for example, that there are substantive research gaps and a considerable lack of coordination between the different water commissions of Central Asia. Therefore, have we put too much hope into these institutions? Did we overestimate the impact of transboundary water governance mechanisms in Central Asia?
They are quite big questions to start with. And maybe before I go into detail, I just one remark. I think when we talk about effectiveness of institutions, be it water institutions in Central Asia or wherever, it's usually quite easy to find something that does not work and to point out, you know, the flaws and the shortcomings. But very often that what works and what has been achieved is kind of taken for granted and it's not seen. And I think we probably will spend quite some time now also discussing what does not work so well and how we can improve that. But I think what is also important to note is that, like you already said, I mean, we have a framework. So we have an institutional framework, we have legal agreements. And this was not something that was expected in the early 1990s. So there were many warnings, again, from the West, who for many experts that, you know, the former Soviet Union was also an unknown territory, who thought, oh my God, new countries, shared rivers, environmental problems, there will be conflict. And to date, I mean, you know, there was no real interstate violent conflict. There were tensions, but so far the countries and the people involved, they were always able to manage it somehow. And especially, you know, when they were really like drought years, other events that required urgent action. So I think that there is this institutional framework that also builds partly on institutions that were there in Soviet time. is an achievement. And even with all the flaws that are there, I mean, they still provide the framework where just discussions are ongoing. So, you know, where commissions, and I think Dinara will talk more about this, commissions meet regularly to discuss water allocation quotas. And okay, then sometimes they might not have an agreement, but these mechanisms are there. And I think that's something other regions might not even have, to have just a structure where the different actors, but also donors, regularly come together and are kind of, you know, forced to continue somehow to exchange information, to try to get to agreements. Now, yeah, and I think also on the more technical level, there are a lot of good experiences also with cooperation, and it's usually different than when you talk about the political level, but then there are also other interests that come in. So I think the institution building, I wouldn't say, you know, it was the wrong focus. I think that's important to focus on this. You can easily put too much focus on a formal institution building, you know, to say, okay, once we have an agreement, then it's fine. But usually, yes, you have an agreement, but then the work starts, because then you have to implement it, then you have to build reporting frameworks, compliance, accountability mechanisms.
Great, Eljana, we're hearing things that, you know, that came up during the discussion, and it's good to know that, we're all on the same page in terms of, yes, the institution building was a good head start, but there are cracks or there are problems that still exist, and you've identified a couple of them. And I'm going to jump over to Dinara. Dinara, you are a field player. You know, you're joining us from Central Asia. You know, you see these things on a daily basis. What we're hearing from Jennifer's response, and also from what the discussion kind of like pointed out, was on regional level, we have these mechanisms, and they have been working towards a cooperative framework when it comes to water governance in Central Asia. But on national level, the implementation, for whatever reason it might be, political or community sentiments, they have been patchy. So what are your thoughts on that? Why is there such a dissection when it comes to agreements happening on regional level, but the lack of implementation on the national level? And how do third-party solicitors, like donors that we talked about, you know, they can come into this and help bridge that gap? External stakeholders, nonprofit organizations, civil society actors, beyond the donors as well, can also support something, if they can, that is, possibly bridge the gap between regional agreements and national implementations. Over to you, Dinara.
Thank you, Farva. I think Jennifer set a very nice scene explaining how regional institutions are working and how they were established. And I think the success is very much, as she said, that it was based on previous practices of water professionals. So it was really something that helped also to implement regional agreements at national level. So it was one main point how regional agreements and regional protocols signed in ICWC were implemented at national level. The difficulties came, I think, with the national restructuring, with the change in the governance structure in general. Because in almost all countries, water ministries or national water agencies start being reorganizing in different way, in very chaotic way sometimes, especially in Kazakhstan. The Water Resources Committee moving from the Ministry of Agriculture to Environment, and then to Energy, and then to Geology and the Natural Resources. And it's even the changing buildings, changing leadership, it's losing capacity. Of course, it's from good intention. They wanted to find a place how water will be managed in the best way, because the most water users were coming from the agriculture sector. They were trying with the agriculture, but it didn't work. And they wanted to try water as a resource. So they start playing in this setting. It's kind of the try of countries to find the best balance, how to implement water-related decision at the national level. And it's still ongoing. Another thing that very much affected water decision is the climate and the context of water management. When we talk about water here in Central Asia, it's a very difficult and complex water infrastructure. So you really cannot talk only about the water management. You have to talk about the whole system of artificial irrigation, drainage channels, etc. And it brings together the whole industry, which was managed in the Soviet time as an almost separate industry, that with the development of the region across the irrigation district. So it was not only ministry, but also very much connected to regional development and rural development. And that's why these attempts to disattach water from other sectors, including from rural development, I think it brought many difficulties for countries to implement those decisions. So it's really very difficult. I think just listen examples from other countries, and many international donors were helping countries to establish national water management system. And if you look at national laws in Kyrgyzstan, and many experts say that they're excellent in terms of the theory of integrated water resources management and institutional building. So the setup established in theory is very well, but the difficulties to put this into practice, how to have enough capacity, financial, institutional, human capacity to basically change the previous system and to introduce completely new system, which is sometimes aligned to traditional approaches in very, most of the time, very centralized system. So I think it's quite a difficult web of challenges. It's not only internal, it's very much, it's not only external, it's very much internal difficulties in national building that also connects to water, because water is just a part of the overall development. And I think it very much shows that we have to be aware of the general governance context in all countries.
I just would like to maybe to make this web even more complicated and to add to this discussion national level, regional level. And I think it's also important to stress, you know, that it's not at the regional level agreements are made and then the national level implements them, but that actually the regional organizations would need to be have a mandate and be strengthened to work themselves in implementing this. So for example, to do like, I don't know, joint data collection. So, you know, so that it's really, and to, and I think also here Dinara can tell also more about these basin organizations. So to really also have the mandate to, for example, monitor the relevant infrastructure to collect the data. Then to see not only all these different national parts, but to have an organization that is truly a regional organization, has this mandate and works not for one country, but for the river basin.
I absolutely agree, Jennifer. Thank you for this clarification. And I think it's indeed the feature of the regional organization, regional water organization in Central Asia, that even the name is the coordination, commission for coordination. It's really for implementation. It has a function of implementation. It's not only it's not only coordinating decision that national authority has to implement, but the commission itself through the executive body also implement. And absolutely right what Jennifer says, the mandate of the basin water organization are not fully support what they have to implement at national ground. So they have a difficulty, even though they have a territorial division in all countries of the basin countries, but sometimes it's even technical difficulties to cross the border, to take the machinery, to do repair work on the interstate channels. So it's all these small technical issues that complicate their daily activities.
Thank you very much for these very important statements and for this very important input, why we still have some issues when it comes to the implementation of regional decisions on a national level. And I think particularly the last point that you mentioned, Jennifer, on the lack of enforcement mechanisms, basically the lack of a mandate where we can push through certain decisions on a national level, are very important. And also thank you for Dinara for mentioning the lack of technical capacities sometimes, which just make it difficult to make sure that what we decide on a regional level is actually pushed through on a national level. Given these shortcomings and given these challenges which the institutions still face in the region, I want to come to a different topic that we also touched upon during our joint working group session. And I think this is related to the challenges that the region still faces, and that's the risk of increasing bilateralism. And as a result of increasing risk of bilateralism, the risk of forum shopping in the region's water diplomacy. Jennifer, you told us in our joint working group session that there is an increasing risk of bilateralism, and I just want to follow up on this. How exactly has this bilateralism manifested itself in the past years, and how big a concern is the trend of bilateralism when it comes to long-term region-wide cooperation?
I think it was Dinara who was talking about this.
Take it up, I'm sorry.
Thank you. Yes, but I would not talk only about the risk, because it's many also very positive developments from the bilateral contacts between the countries. And it's, for example, between the Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, they have the bilateral commissions, and Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan for many years, for 25 years, they were dealing bilaterally with the water allocation in the lower reaches. So it's not completely new practice, but what we've seen in the last 3, 4, 5 probably years, that we have more bilateral contacts between other countries, between Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, and Tajikistan, and also with Afghanistan and Tajikistan. And what might be implication of these bilateral contacts, in addition to many, many good things that can happen in terms of the implementation. But I think we have to be aware, and the parties and countries have to be aware, that all bilateral relation has to be really in line with the regional interest and the regional based in wide development. Because the bilateral contacts, for example, in Sirdarya River between the Uzbekistan and Kyrgyzstan, and Kyrgyzstan and Kazakhstan bilaterally, it doesn't help to have agreed multilateral water management in Sirdarya on water releases from Toktogul, for example. Sometimes one of the countries gets upset that it was not invited to these bilateral talks between the countries. And it's also Tajikistan sometimes unhappy that these bilateral talks happening between the Sirdarya countries. And also with Afghanistan coming into the normal, let's say, stabilization situation in the countries, which is very good sign for the country's development. But we have to understand that it's riparian countries to Amu Darya, and it's on the upstream reaches, and that's why all development will be affecting all other countries. And I think all countries have to be interested in regional wide development of the basin, so there is no concerns of the possible transboundary impact. And I think it's a very good chance for all countries to try to work on the regional basin wide vision of the development of water. And I think for international partners, it's really a nice avenue to support countries in these basin-wide developments, trying to bring them all together in joint research, as Jennifer mentioned, on joint monitoring and data exchange, because I think it's a good start for building trust and building relation between the countries. As we talked at the beginning of our conversation, what we have in Central Asia now, it's a legacy of water relations between the countries in the past. So with Afghanistan, we also have to build that kind of relations to have at least to know the people, because, you know, it's we talk about institution, but in fact, we talk about people. It very much depends who is the leading national water agency, for example, to see how the dynamic change within the commission.
Dinara, thank you very much. And you kind of like summed it up so well for us, the topic of bilateralism. And I'm going to pick on what you said, you know, not invited. It sounds like, you know, in high school when you say you can't sit with us. And that kind of mentality can be very taken in a very negative light, especially when you look at it from a geopolitical standpoint. Now, I come here in this topic from an area of my focus and interest as well. In South Asia, in the Himalayan region, bilateralism is like the key player when it comes to anything and everything, right? Especially on transboundary rivers. We have bilateral sort of mechanisms that exist between India-Nepal, India-Bangladesh, India-Pakistan, but there's no regional platform. There's no regional inclusiveness, and that's where the region lacks. Where there's been, continued debate, attempt at effort in sort of bringing a regional platform together to bring these riparian countries who are, heavy hitters to talk about these issues and set the political sentiments aside and bring the regional interest. And you mentioned the people and connecting with the people. And I think that's where where the region itself is hoping that, people-to-people connectivity, these issue areas to be discussed on that multi-stakeholder level. But you also mentioned Afghanistan. We heard this during the segment during our JWG session as well, that it's important to have an inclusive Afghanistan. It's the second largest contributor to the Amudarya. You can't not invite that country. But it has been, unfortunately, that case. It's still not inclusive in the IFAS and other platforms where it should be a contender. You mentioned some ways forward, but I would like both of you, Jennifer Dinara, to deep dive into what role are you foreseeing for these commissions that are already set up and external players and donors to support Afghanistan's inclusiveness in the transboundary water governance conversations?
Well, I think any effort, and there are efforts certainly underway already, but it also has to work on both sides. So one side is on the side of Central Asians who, there is willingness to include Afghanistan, to talk with Afghanistan, but there is certainly also, as leaders, I sense it as an outsider, some kind of fear that, it's already complicated enough. So, now you get another factor in it. But also on the side of Afghanistan, yes, there is the wish to be included, but there are also fears that, are we well prepared enough? Do we have, for example, the data to also substantiate then our positions? Do we have the best negotiation capacities, or the fear then, to maybe get into agreement that is not favorable for them? So I think both sides have to be prepared. Yeah, but then there were, for example, Afghan-Tajikistan, there is a bilateral cooperation, and with all, the negative side effects maybe of this bilateralism, but this can then also be a start to say, we cannot get it into this whole high level formal regional platforms, but we start at least with this hydrological data exchange and that was supported between Afghanistan and Tajikistan to at least, build the basis for trust building, enable some networks, get some contacts, because even, if they are not a part of the formal mechanisms, also establishing these working relations between the people in the ministries, that they just have contacts, know each other. That's also a step which might not be visible, in any formal agreements, but which at the end also eases the water management in the basin.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. And I think at the very end, you actually mentioned a topic that I want to touch on a bit, and that's the role of informal networks and the importance of informal networks in Central Asian water diplomacy. Because what we have learned also in the joint working group session that there are a number of informal networks in Central Asia, and even sometimes a sentiment of brotherhood in Central Asian policy circles. And I would like to talk about that a little, because I think it kind of adds a cultural dimension and an identity dimension to the region's water diplomacy. Dinara, since you're from Central Asia yourself, can you tell us a bit what exactly is the role of culture and identity in Central Asia's water diplomacy? And how exactly did the sentiment of brotherhood influence cross-border water cooperation in the past?
Indeed, but it was mentioned by Jennifer on the brotherhood. And it's interesting that in preparing article for the journal quite recently, we analyzed exactly the same point that Jennifer was mentioning about brotherhood. I looked at the provision of the convention that was signed between Central Asian countries, and in the preamble of the of these agreements, what you can see, it's all about brotherhood. It's basically the whole agreement based on this concept. And another thing about identity, we just finished the assessment of the statements of the Central Asian countries made in the General Assembly of the UN for last 30 years. And we looked at how their attitude towards the region. Parva mentioned that in South Asia, it's more bilateral relations, but it's completely different in Central Asia. Starting from the third statement and the UN General Assembly, countries talk about the region and align themselves, associate themselves with the region. It's all about Central Asia. Actually, Afghanistan, it's one of the three main topics that was raised by all countries in their statements. So it's really something that countries talk about, and they're not seeing themselves as separated from the region. And we even see the call for wider Central Asia, including Afghanistan, in the statement of some countries. So I think it's quite significant and very strong spirit of the brotherhood and this identity of the region. But saying that, we have to also to understand that till now we don't have a very strong regional institution except the International Fund for Saving the Aral Sea. It was the only regional body that has five Central Asian countries, but now we don't have Kyrgyzstan, unfortunately. So even though countries talk about Central Asian unity, Central Asian regional integration in different way, connecting the culturally, connecting economically, transport, transit, communication, but unfortunately it did not materialize in very strong regional organizations. So hopefully it's our next very near future that countries can realize all what they were talking for 30 years.
Thank you very much, Janora, and also Jennifer, for bringing this up and discussing the sentiment of brotherhood. It's definitely something that, it's unique in the terminology, while it's used in several ways and are all around the world. In Central Asia, it has its own meaning. You touched upon, and you just said it yourself, lastly, that we still waiting for it to be materialized in a manner and realized in a manner that it's truly appreciated and we can take it forward. Now, speaking of forward, how do you think that these, what's the future of these informal networks and the brotherhood sentiment? Just wanted to get your thoughts on that.
It's not easy to make predictions for the future, but maybe also to follow up on Dinara, I think that, certainly, you have both. I mean, you have this strong idea of the region or of the neighborhood, which it seems, and there are also local scholars, international relations scholars who also work on this and say, these Western international relations approaches might not necessarily fit here because these national sovereignty and then cooperation might not be strictly separated because the nation is thought as part of, this region. And it might be something that can be positively exploited, but as you say, Farwa, I think, when then other interests come in, it can also be forgotten. So I think it's worthwhile to think about, okay, how can this be further fostered and strengthened? And I think one example where we see where actually this strong feeling of community is at work is the water community. So are these Vodniki, water experts that also, especially the older generation who, grew up in the Soviet Union and shared the same education. So they have the same ideas about how water should be managed. Russian is still, the language to communicate across the country. So there is this community. And I think what's important and where I also would see a role for the EU, if I may come already to that point, is to say, okay, how can we transfer this to the new generation that now grew up in individual nation states, but which is also mobile. So, and then Europe has, you know, they in Europe we have Erasmus programs and so on. So we have all these schemes that bring young people together that enable them also to have this regional identity. So I think that's really something key. How is this idea of the region and of the neighborhood can be kind of nurtured with the new generation that grew up now in the independent states?
Thank you very much, Jennifer. Very important points here. And actually, you touched on one point that I would like to address, even though we slowly have to come to an end of our debate today. But you mentioned the role of the EU, and obviously for us here in Brussels, that's of major importance because the EU, along with many other donors, has been very active in Central Asia's water diplomacy throughout the past decades. And yet real positive results of donor engagement have been limited. So Jennifer, perhaps you can dive in a bit deeper into this topic. Why exactly were donors unable to contribute to long-term solutions on Central Asia's water diplomacy? I also ask a question because the EU very much likes to portray itself as a key actor in Central Asia's water issues. But if positive results are limited, isn't the EU running the risk of furthering its well-known expectations capabilities gap? And Dinara, perhaps that's a follow-up question for you too. What are the concrete expectations of Central Asian actors towards the EU when it comes to water diplomacy? Do you have any recommendations for our Brussels-based listeners?
I think there is not like, you know, there is not like one reason to say that's why the EU or other donors were not as successful. I mean, certainly many factors come into play, and sometimes there's also just, you know, political development, historical circumstances. So now to focus more on the EU side, I mean, I think also for donors have many interests, and apart from the noble ideal of fostering peace and sustainable development. So there are also certain, you know, you have project cycles, you have to show visible results after 3 years. So there are also all these conditions that also limit what donors can do and how they frame projects. And I think that in the beginning, I think there was also a lot of kind of exporting models from the West to Central Asia, which, you know, to a region that has thousands of years of irrigation history. So, you know, there were also some questions marked. And I think there is a lot of homegrown expertise. And now also, you know, there are young, bright minds who really also studied abroad, come back to their region. So they have both worlds where they have the knowledge from. So I think, where I think really the EU's role is that the EU is also a region that has grown together and that, you know, always has the balance between the nation states and the EU as a body. So I would see the role of the EU not so much in water related solutions, like in, you know, technical things, that's how you manage, but rather on how to have this process of coming as a region together, build joint visions, overcoming these obstacles in the process, finding, you know, sharing benefits, sharing costs that appear. So I think this more process related or maybe also cultural, if you want to say, experiences, that's something I would think could be of value. But Dinara is in a better position to say what you can offer.
Surely I cannot say for the whole region. It's just my very personal subjective view on EU, also based on some readings on the perception of the countries of EU. So that it's on project based, that sometimes it's too bureaucratic, it's a burden to get the projects from EU, and what Jennifer already mentioned, it's a very short cycle and so many difficulties, and the really countries sometimes don't understand what's happening and what's the real result. And I think although completely supporting what Jennifer said about the importance of the process, I think it's also very essential to combine these activities with the concrete results, the project that can bring concrete results. Because sometimes countries get upset that we had this kind of meetings, the dialogue, high level dialogues, And what's at the end? It's kind of, for them, very difficult to measure, and they get upset that it's so many millions were spent for just talks. And although everyone understands that it's very important to keep talking and building the process and dialogue, but when it's combined with also something concrete on the ground, so you can bring to this high level discussion some results of field work at the national programs, I think it's a very, it brings additional value of what you're doing at the high level. So really vertically kind of trying to connect different levels. And also from, I think it's also very important horizontal integration and connection. We talk a lot about the nexus on water, energy and food nexus, but unfortunately many meetings that I've been, it's we talk about the nexus only with the water people, very rare inviting the people from other sectors, and never actually other sectors talk about the nexus. So it's more kind of water side driven process, but it's not emerging and integrated in other sectors. So it's just the change of the name for integrated water resources management sometimes for the nexus, not inviting other sectors and not really engaging them in what we want to achieve. So I would say that it has to be both the kind of vertical integration of the result, but also kind of a nexus approach that can bring different sectors so we can see the result of these fuzzy words that's used a lot, but it's very difficult to understand what it means for practitioners. It's more policy making terms that it's not converted into practical things yet.
Thank you very much for these, I think, very clear expectations actually towards the EU. So what we basically need, I think what I learned is here, more horizontal integration. So basically a stronger nexus approach and intersectoral integration, not only bringing people together from the water sector, but also bringing people from the energy sector, agricultural sector, the food sector. And also what I think is important, that sometimes we need concrete results. And I think that's actually a fair point. It cannot always be about, you know, talking and having discussions. Sometimes you also need a real impact on the ground. Unfortunately, I have to close the debate slowly if there are no further comments. But Faber, you wanted to say something.
I just want to say, and it's going to be a plug for the work that we are doing, is the multi-stakeholder engagement that you touched upon, Janora, you know, having people from the other sectors, and Louis just reiterated that. That's the core of the work that we've been hoping to do and we've been delivering in order to make the impact, because we truly feel that it has to be a holistic approach. It cannot be treated in silos. It will get us nowhere. It's been happening in silos forever, and we know where we're standing, clearly. So this is what we're moving towards, and with the support and engagement of experts like yourself and the community that we're trying to reach out to, hopefully we'll be able to make the impact or play a little part in creating that impact that we just talked about. So we're back to you, Louis. I just wanted to plug in.
Thank you very much, Faber. Unfortunately, we have to come to an end of the debate, but thank you very much for a very rich debate. I think very very much good food for thought for both Central Asian actors and European policymakers. Thank you also to all of our listeners that you joined us. And of course, special thanks to Faber, Jennifer and Dinara for being on board. We'll be back soon with a new fresh discussion, bridging the gap between the EU and the Global South. In the meantime, we invite you to follow us on LinkedIn, Twitter and Facebook. You can find all the necessary links in the description. And we look forward to the next discussion. Until then, stay safe and goodbye.